This is David Heine. We're here today at Conscious Dreams with Jeroen Berger. He is one of the original founders of Conscious Dreams. Could you tell us a little about how this started?
Well, it started in October 1993 when we opened up the shop in the Kerkstraat in the center of Amsterdam as a small gallery with some natural products. And it wasn't even called a smart shop at that time because the word just didn't exist. And, well, it was pretty hard times. We were in the middle of the art scene and in the middle of some alternative herbal products, but nobody really knew what it was. And then in the summer of 1994, we started with the sales of the magic mushrooms, which were legal and are still legal in Holland, but were always in a sort of an underground circuit going around and used. And, well, there came a lot of people to the shop that asked us for mushrooms, and we figured out that they were legal. So we decided to sell them just over the counter, with a lot of product information and a lot of knowledge to make them more available for people, but also to make the use of the mushrooms more safe because of the information we gave. And that decision to sell the mushrooms legally over the counter got so much attention from our customers, but also from the media, that within 2 weeks we had rows of people waiting outside the shop to buy the mushrooms and all kinds of media coming from all over the world to, well, report from this new phenomenon that was going on, of course, in Amsterdam, where else. And this is basically how it started. And then when we got so much attention all over the world, also a lot of people who were working with psychoactive substances underground in other countries discovered that there was becoming a new market in Holland for these products. So we got a lot of people who were producing products or investigating stuff coming to us and say, hey, do you want to sell our products or do you want to try this? So within no time, we changed from a little art gallery with some 10 products to a shop that had 50, 40 different psychoactive products and herbs and all kinds of food supplements, just to be a total concept of body and mind awareness. And this is still what it is. It's a concept that we say that if you take psychoactive substances or other substances to, well, change your mind or illuminate it a little bit, you also have to take care, good care of your body. So this is why we offer a broad range of herbal product, herbal alternatives for maybe dangerous chemical drugs, but also provide the essential substances to make you feel more healthy afterwards.
Now, when you're passing out this information, is this something that you've developed yourself or you've taken the information? Where does it come from? I mean, a lot of the experimenting actually was cut off by government intervention, and then...
Yeah.
How did you develop this?
Well, it's basically a combination of a lot of desk research. I mean, there's a lot of books, of course, about psychedelics, how to use them, where they come from. On the other hand, the people who started Conscious Dreams, themselves had a lot of experience checking out the substances. And of course, also all the people came to the shop. We asked them to come back to report about their experiences. So, this is what we do now for more than 5 years. So, I mean... It's a self-growing system. People are always willing to experiment with these substances. And this is also how we learn from them, what they do. And this is what we still integrate in our product information and about advice that we can give to people, how they use it, what they should do with it, and what they should not do with it. So, I mean, it's a combination of everything that has been known from the past and even from 1,000 years ago, what we know ourselves and what we learn from our customers.
Now, do young people come in here and buy mushrooms, and what do you say to them when they want?
Well, we have decided not to sell any psychoactive substances to people under 18 years, and this is something we decided ourselves because there is no law in Holland that that makes that illegal. I mean, normally we could say that we could sell mushrooms, let's say, to a 10-year-old kid, but of course we don't do that because the effect of the mushrooms is, well, quite intense, and we don't want any young people to get disturbed by that. So, of course, there's a lot of interest from young people to use psychoactive substances, not only from Dutch people, but also from young people that come from outside Holland. But we don't sell it under 18 years. So, in fact, you can say that the biggest group of people that come to the smart shop is somewhere between 18 and 35 years old. But we also have customers from 65 or from 80 years old. So it's pretty much everyone who's interested in the products we sell.
Now this year, Conscious Dreams, I think, sponsored a large psychedelic conference here in town, you were instrumental in organizing it and having it. How did that go, and how many people came to that?
Well, it was there was room for about 450 people, and eventually 400 people came up from all over the world. And we had some very interesting speakers like Alexander and Sasha Shulgin, like Jonathan Ott, like Alex Gray. And we even had our mystery guest, Albert Hoffman, who turned 93 this year, coming up from Switzerland to have a talk to the psychonauts here in Amsterdam who gathered and shared their new knowledge. And, well, this was pretty much the crown on our work of 5 years pioneering in the psychoactive field, that we could organize something that was really about research, about psychoactivity, which was also the name of the conference, all the way. And I think we can say it was a big success.
Well, when you've started this now rolling again, it seems that we're in a second wave of psychedelic, and this time, much like it was actually in the 60s in America, it was legal then. People could actually take it, and then it was all cut off, as well as all the government experimenting and any kind of scientific. In fact, there was only one permit, I think, for a long time. Do you feel that there is going to be a renewal in actually science application or some more formal studies being done?
Well, I think the difference between the 60s and now is that I don't know if the government will be really interested in experimenting with psychoactive substances as, well, maybe as medicines or stuff like that. But I think that now the pharmaceutical industry realized themselves that the science they did the last 100 years is a dead-end road. And they turned to natural substances from, let's say, the rainforest also to make new medicines. So I think also the curing with plants and with psychoactive substances has a renewed interest from the pharmaceutical industry themselves. And besides that, there's also, of course, social developments, like people get more interested in new age, in spiritual things. And also because the world is getting so small, because like developments like the internet, like telecommunications, a lot of the knowledge that has been isolated from elder cultures in, let's say, South America is now coming up to the West. And that, combined with renewed interest for spirituality, also makes more people interested in the use of psychoactive substances. And we noticed that the use of psychoactive substances, not as a recreational drug, but mainly as something that helps you to develop on a spiritual level, is becoming very popular. And we noticed that also the drug users that use drugs as recreational substances like ecstasy or cocaine is also a small switch towards more psychoactive or psychedelic substances. So, I mean, in general, you can say that there is, from different angles, a renewed interest in what plant spirits can do for you.
Now, we know that there was a resurgence in drugs that were not exactly safe or in any way beneficial to the body or the mind in many ways. The cocaine, as you say, the crack, which is an epidemic form in America. Yeah. Here, is this the only country where psychedelic drugs are actually legal and where there's some organized thought going into the use of them?
Well, I think it's not the only country where psychedelics are legal, especially in I think in the countries where the psychedelic plants originate from, they are probably all legal. But I think Holland is the only country where the distribution of these psychedelic substances is that much organized as it is in shops, where the shops have an organization where they are gathered and talk to the government about the safe use of it. So I think the existence of smart shops here in Holland is pretty much a first experiment in an alternative for the war on drugs. Like, okay, we're not going to make everything illegal, but let's review some substances. Maybe it's better to sell them in a restricted way where you can talk about diminishing the risks and stuff like that, than to make them illegal so that they appear on the black market where there's a lot of criminality involved and black money. Instead of that, let's see what happens when you sell it in a shop with a lot of information, with safe dosages, and where you can actually also tell the customer to stick to that advice so that no accidents will happen. And it turns out to be that after five years of experimenting with that, since the first smart shop started here, it seems to be a very good alternative. And we can actually prove that, because when you look at the mushrooms, the active substances, psilocybin and psilocin, are actually listed here in Holland as opium list one, as hard drugs, except the mushroom is not, and that's why it's legal to sell it. So obviously the government considers it to be a very dangerous hard drug. But when you take it as a mushroom, like it's offered in a smart shop, it doesn't appear to be that dangerous, because if you can advise people to stick to the dosage and use it in a safe environment, no accidents will happen. And that's what happened the last 5 years. So we've actually proven in practice that substances that are listed at this moment are probably better off if they would get off the list and be sold in a regulated setting with a lot of advice.
When you say dosages, now my friend Terence McKenna recommends 6 dried grams and darkness and being alone, which might seem a little risky for a beginning user. Yeah. What do you recommend when someone comes in and asks you what really to do?
Well, when you look at specifically the mushrooms, we sell them fresh. The dosage we sell, let's say for the Mexican mushroom, we have several species. It's 30 grams fresh mushrooms, which is a... It's an average dose. Of course, it's average numbers because, I mean, you have big people, you have small people, you have people with slow metabolisms, with fast metabolism. So it's an average dose, which we learned from experience over the years. And these are very safe dosages. I mean, a man like Terence McKenna would probably be not interested in that type of dosages because he uses it for shamanistic purposes. And what we do here is to offer it for a large public, and that means that we have to work with safe dosages. And even if people come in, we always ask them if they've used mushrooms before. If they have not, we advise them to take half the dosage of the 30 grams, which is 15 grams, which is a very low, mild dosage. But we just want people to experiment with it, to see what happens to them. If they like it, they can always eat more. But if we give them a big dose and they don't like it, it's hard to get out. So this is the way we do it. We always work with average safe dosages, and it turns out to be safe because no accidents happen. And of course, if people want a real shamanistic experience, they can always buy 2 dosages and use the double amount of mushrooms they want to use. But I mean, that's up to their own responsibility, of course. We would never advise that to anyone who never tried mushrooms before or does it for the second time.
Now, I notice you have things other than mushrooms. You have some San Pedro cactuses, some mescaline, or some peyote, actually. Yeah. Where do you get these things?
Well, they come from all over the world. The mushrooms in general are grown artificially here in Holland by growers. Some of the species you cannot grow indoors, so they actually come from the fields, let's say in Wales or Scotland, and are brought into the Netherlands. The San Pedro cactus is pretty much the same story. We have San Pedro coming from South America, but we also have growers here in Holland who grow the San Pedros themselves. And we are very careful with that, like, for example, the peyote cactus, which is now to be considered as an endangered species because of the massive use of the Native American church. We wouldn't think of buying peyotes that actually come from the desert. So when we know that plants are endangered species in the wild, we only buy them from indoor growers. But if you look at the other products we sell, like herbs, like synthetical products, they come from all over the world. Herbs come from China, from South America, from India, they come from North America, from everywhere. So it's worldwide business, so to say.
And they can just come into Holland that way then?
Yes, they can. Yeah, as long as the substance is not listed here in Holland as a drug or a medicine, it can be imported or exported just as a normal substance, yeah.
Now, I noticed some of your nutrients and some of the natural products are for sexual enhancement and other forms of ideas. How do you get those?
Well, a part of the sexual enhancement products are actually herbs, which are known for their potency raising qualities. And there's also synthetical substances that like, for example, we have a precursor of a substance called GHB. It has been pretty much in the news in America also. It's now listed as a medicine here in Holland, but there's a precursor to it that if you take it, it's being converted into your body, into GHB, which is a natural occurring substance in your body, which is one of the strongest aphrodisiacs. And I think it has always been, for thousands of years, has been known to mankind to use extra substances like yohimbe, like ephedra, to give more energy to your sex life. So, I mean, it's something really very old, but it's also now in the new society or this current society that we still use it for that purpose. And they come from all over the world also. Especially the precursor I just talked about actually comes from America.
Land of Puritans.
Probably. Yeah. Yeah, obviously.
So, when you're distributing the various kinds of, or selling the various kinds of psychedelic substances, I noticed you had Datura and other forms. Do you try to get a sense of the person you're selling it to, or do you have time for that?
Oh yeah, definitely. Well, we always try to take the time. I mean, we know that if somebody comes in for a little can of Red Bull energy drink, we don't have to worry so much about what's going to happen. But I mean, if people start asking about mushrooms, about San Pedro cactus, Datura is something we don't sell, but we just show it as a plant. Well, we always try to figure out, we try to ask people, do you have experience with this? How are you going to use it? What do you think it will do to you? Because a lot of people, especially when they come from outside Holland, they think it's just for fun. Everything is for fun. And they have no idea how potent these products can be. So it happens a lot of time that when we talk to these people for a few minutes, they say, okay, I don't want it anymore, because they have a totally wrong idea about what it's going to do to them. And on the other hand, if it turns out to be that people have a lot of experience, know what they're doing, know what they talk about, and this is pretty easy for us to check, because the people here behind the counter, they are all specialists. They know about from reading, they know about it from own experience. So if somebody talks about mushrooms and it's obviously that he never made a trip before, we will probably not sell it to him. And this is actually what we sometimes do. We say, okay, listen, it appears to us that you don't really know what you're doing, so yeah, we won't sell to you. And that's not a guarantee that they cannot buy it anywhere else, but at least we take our responsibility not to sell it to persons who want to, well, let's say, abuse the psychoactive substances we have.
Now, you were the first shop, the first smart shop in Amsterdam, and you started a phenomena that they're everywhere. They're all over, not only Amsterdam, but all over Holland. How do you feel about that? And do you, as an owner, get together with other smart shops and discuss the developments? How you're doing? What's going on?
Yeah, of course. Yeah. Well, of course, we feel very happy that that the growth of the number of smart shops, and that it being such a phenomenon here in Holland, is such a thing that's been there for about 5 years now. Because we feel that it's really important that people can get good advice on products. And our approach is always, and that's totally different from the government's point of view, is that we say that people want to use drugs, and we know that for sure because they come in and ask for it. And well, we believe that if you're not interested in drugs, you probably won't come in here because, well, you don't want to use it. And for those people who are interested in it, they will be, I think they will be better off when they can buy it just from us or from another smart shop where they can get good products, safe dosages, good advice, instead from buying it from a dealer, not knowing what they get no advice, probably get risky products. And there's another little latent group of users, people maybe with products or younger, so with problems, or maybe younger people that are getting interested in drugs. But I think it's much better also if they would come to a smart shop and get informed. We don't sell it to them, but at least they can get informed about what's going to happen. So, and it turns also out to be that over the number of years we've experienced that a lot of people who never tried drugs before but are interested and are on that point, okay, I want to try something, rather go to a smart shop and have themselves really good informed than going to a dealer and buy something like that. So, I mean, we are actually very happy to see that there's over 150 smart shops here, and actually has been sort of standardized, like every city has its smart shops, and sort of accepted that there is a place where you can go to buy legal highs and where you can also go to get good information about it. And, well, because of the fast growth of this phenomenon, something about 2 years ago that it actually started, because Conscious Dreams have been the only smart shop for 2.5 years because everybody thought it would be illegal soon. But then after 2.5 years, it turns out to be okay. So a lot of shops started after that. So, I mean, the growth of, let's say, 150 smart shops has been done in 2 years, let's say two and a half years. So that also, together with this fast growth, we have also encountered a lot of problems, of course, and also less responsible people coming into the market and trying to sell products. So we had to organize ourselves, and we decided to be proactive and go to the government and say, okay, listen, this is what we do, this is how we organize, and we want to talk with you to see what's best to do, to discuss things, to discuss matters, what products are legal, what products are illegal, what do you think about products, what do you think about dosages. So from the beginning of last year, we got accepted as an official spokespartner from the government to discuss this whole smart shop matter. So that actually means that there is a policy, a Dutch policy, in the government about smart shops, how to handle that. And I think that's, well, that's pretty good, because we are in an open dialogue with the government, And that doesn't mean that if there would be dangerous products or illegal things happening, that the government would do something. But I mean, it's always better to talk first and to let each other know what you're doing than to have no communication and be more or less a threat to each other, which is, I'm happy to say, is not the case here in Holland. So we have a very good understanding with the government, especially the Ministry of Health, who's very interested in what we're doing, also especially in the experimental part of, okay, what happens when you don't make substances illegal, but what happens if you sell them in a regulated setting with a lot of information? Is it really that dangerous as we think? And it turns out to be that a lot of substances are much better off regulated than made illegal. And one of the things, well, what we hope for is that also a drug like ecstasy, which is now illegal and causes a lot of problems. I mean, the estimate here in Holland is that there is about 250,000 users every week which have to buy on the illegal market and get bad quality, that it would probably be an idea if the government would accept that these people want to use the drug, that it would be better off if they control the production. I mean, the government would appoint, let's say, three companies that make the drug under strict rules, everybody knows what's in it, and that it's only sold in Holland in, let's say, about 100 places where everybody knows what they get good quality, and I think a lot of less accidents will happen.
Now, a friend of mine, when I told him that we were going to come and talk to you, he said, you know, those smart shops, they're all underground people. They're all, they've been taken over by the underground already. Do you find any of that to be happening?
No, not at all. I mean, well, obviously it's not underground because it's pretty much above the ground. And I think it's also obviously that, I mean, legal substances and stuff that is being sold in a normal shop like any other shop is not interesting for the underground, because the underground is there because the illegality makes it very interesting to sell these products. And I mean, what we do, well, how can it be interesting for a criminal person to pay taxes and to be in the open like this? So, I mean, there's no criminal involvement at all. And all the way from the production to the sales in the shop, it's all regulated, it's being controlled. Everybody pays taxes, so, well, there's no criminal involvement at all. At least, not that we notice here.
Now, I notice that you still integrate art, various kinds of psychedelic art, with your products. Is this an ongoing policy for you here at Conscious Dreams?
Yes, it is. Well, our concept is pretty much body and mind awareness, and that means that everything, we don't sell the products we do just as we want to sell legal highs and just use it as a recreational drug. We want to offer it to people as part of a conscious lifestyle. And it means that also has to do with music, with art, with information. And we know that the people who take these substances we sell are also having normal jobs and just functioning normal in the society. So, I mean, everything that has to do with psychedelics or mind expansion in a broad sentence of the word, we'd like to see to people, because most of the art we sell is, of course, inspired by also the products we sell. So we also want to show to the people what good can come from it if you take these psychedelics in many forms.
Now, do you find that there's a special kind of person that comes in and buys psychedelics from you?
Oh, no, it's really everybody. I mean, it varies from 18 to 65. It's men, women, it's hetero, homosexual. It's pretty much everyone we have on this planet visits us with different questions and for different purposes. And I think that's also the most interesting part of what we do, is that we talk to so many different people. And that's also a big source of inspiration.
Now, do you see your business blossoming to a larger degree, experimenting with more psychoactive substances, or where are you going with this whole phenomena?
Well, that's pretty hard to say, because we would never expect it 5 years ago that we would end up here. But I mean, I think the smart shop phenomenon has pretty much been established as a type of shop, and I think that over the years some products will disappear and new products will be found, and also that also goes for psychoactive substances, of course. I mean, maybe something will be made illegal because it turns out to be dangerous. Of course, there's an ongoing investigation towards new plants, and so that means we will always have new products, and some products be disappearing, maybe made illegal, maybe because people don't find them interesting anymore. Because the use of substances like this has always been also a hype. Over the history, some products have been interesting for 5 years and then nobody wants to use it anymore. So this is something we also notice. But I think the smart shop as a phenomenon, as an information center about legal drugs or drug use in general, is pretty much established. And I think that's basically the main function we have in society at this moment. And the product range, I think it will change forever and ever. Yeah.
Well, We both know that there are other forms that are very popular in other places, like ayahuasca, for example. Would you see yourself getting into ayahuasca or that area of experiment?
For sure. I mean, we especially the people who work at Conscious Dreams have pretty good experiences with taking ayahuasca themselves. But I don't think it would be a product that we would sell here in the shop because, in fact, when we got first, we first got questions about ayahuasca, which is about a few years ago. We didn't know so much about it, so we decided to ask a shaman from Peru to come over, and he actually came over and attended a few rituals with us. And well, from the power that the plant has and the setting where it's being done, we thought it wouldn't be a good idea, also from point of view from respect to the plant, just to sell it like this over the counter and tell people, okay, just cook your own ayahuasca and drink it and see what happens. Because especially the setting with the use of ayahuasca is so important, and the control of the, well, let's say, the shaman in the ritual, that it would be possible for us to sell it from a legal point of view, because ayahuasca is legal. But we wouldn't do it because of the responsibility we think we should take in protecting any accidents or protecting people from any accidents that may happen because of the strength of the plant. Luckily enough, there's a lot of people here in Amsterdam who organize ceremonies with the ayahuasca. So if people are interested, we can always tell them that there are guided ceremonies in Amsterdam that they can attend and have the ayahuasca experience anyway, but not buy it as a product and use it at home without any knowledge about dosages or setting that it has to be used in.
Now, would you see yourself getting into the more chemical kind of psychedelics like LSD, DMT, that form? Is that an attractive area to head towards?
Well, it's the drugs you mentioned, like LSD and DMT, are illegal here in Holland, so we probably could never get into that. But there are a lot of chemical substances, of course, that might be very interesting for their use. We ourselves, we don't really distinguish that much that we say that natural products are better than chemical ones. I mean, after all, even if you ingest a plant, it's being turned into chemistry in your body. So in the end, it's all chemical, let's say it that way. But I think there's a lot of interest, especially here in Holland, for chemical substances because of the, well, it's so easy to take. It's in a tablet, and people also in the use of drugs are pretty much, want to comfort themselves, not cooking for 8 hours and making all kinds of mystic brews like that. But I think there is more interesting substances in terms of psychoactive effects and plant spirits than chemical substances. I mean, it's obvious. For me, it is. But I mean, there's always people interested in that. And as long as it's legal and it would be safe and it won't have very much side effects, it can be an interesting product to offer to people, yes, as an alternative for maybe herbal products.
Well, thank you very much for being with me today. It's been a delight talking with you.
Thank you.
Well, here we are inside of Conscious Dreams, the first smart shop in all of Amsterdam, with the resident expert, Walter, who's going to tell us really a little bit about what a customer, and that's me, would like to know about magic mushrooms and buying them in probably one of the only places in the Western world where you can buy them legally. So, Walter, let's just pretend that I've never had a magic mushroom in my life.
Yes.
And I'm in here, and I see you have several varieties. Could you tell me a little about each of them?
Yeah, well, first, if you want to buy them, you have to be over 18 to buy them. That's a standard rule in all the smart shops. If you're one of the first timers, I say go for either one of the less strong ones, or the energy one, or the funny one. They labor strength. This is the weaker one till the stronger one. I mostly recommend people who do the first time get a funny trip. In general, the Mexican is more the funny. Tickles your brain a bit and makes you laugh. It changes your perception of how you look on life and general things. A lot of people like it and giggle. Some people won't like it. They're more like a little scary state. But with mushrooms, it's mostly no harm. It only takes 4 hours, then you're done.
Well, let's say, for a person about my size, of the Mexican, what would you recommend?
I'd recommend one box is enough for two people. We always recommend do it together. It's more fun do it together. It's because then you have, a response from somebody who's doing the same thing as you and is on the same kind of level that you are. So we'd recommend one box for two people. It's 25 guilders. And do it where you feel comfortable. It could be in your home, in your hotel room. But you can also take out a silent spot in nature. Nature is very beautiful.
So you don't recommend the Terence McKenna six dried grams and silent darkness by yourself?
Well, I could recommend it, but don't do it the first time. Get used to mushrooms. And if you're used to it, you probably after a while you know how far you can go, how much you can take. And then still again, keep up to some rules like do it, certainly if you take high dose like that, do it with somebody who is sober so he can control you if you're doing something weird. If you want to do high doses, keep it safe.
Now, I never think of mushrooms as a party drug myself. I see them more in perhaps a shamanic context. When the people come in here to buy them, what generally are they looking for?
In general, they're looking for, it's something else than marijuana, which we can try. Usually, as we sell it, it's low dose. So it makes them giggle. So they can tell at home, hey, we tried mushrooms, they were fun. And of course, you can use them as, I wouldn't recommend them as party drugs. Because parties means lots of people, and it means lots of different input. And usually on mushrooms, it's hard to keep track of the input. We recommend them as funny things to do at home or with some friends out in the open. If you want to do shamanic research or experiences, there are some groups here in Amsterdam that do sessions also with mushrooms. It means you have to search for a bit more, but if you're really into it, you will search for it. So that's it.
Well, tell me a little about the origin of smart shops.
The origin, well, till in Holland, a lot of Americans will think marijuana is legal. It's not, it's illegal, but the police, the government, they don't bother, except when you're doing big things like big plantations or selling lots to get more money. With mushrooms, it's a bit different. Actually, mushrooms, the mushroom itself is not named in the law, but psilocybin is named in the law. There was in 1993, there was called the CAT conference. CAT is what Somalians use to chew on, religious, and gives them more energy. But the actual ingredient is illegal, but the CAT itself, the leaves and the stems, were not. So then our boss thought, hey, if that's true, then it's the same with mushrooms. You can sell mushrooms, but you cannot sell the actual psilocybin. And then he started with the shop and see if he got caught or not. And he had a very good lawyer, and together they kind of made it through. And it's been 5 or 6 years since. And government's still looking for ways to get restriction, more restriction on it. But it's been here and we hope it's going to stay. Otherwise I'll lose my job. Well, I'll find something else.
I noticed that you also, over here in the grow room, you also have some peyote. Do you sell that?
We sell peyote, we sell San Pedro. Peyote is the same story. Mescaline is named in the law, so we cannot sell mescaline. But we can sell peyote, because peyote in Holland is not named in law. In America, it's Schedule 1. Everything, the buttons, till the roots, till the earth surrounding it probably also. But in Holland you can sell it, that's why we do it. But if there was a tree that would grow LSD, well, we probably would sell the tree, but we're not allowed to sell LSD. That kind of story.
Well, when a person comes in here, a lot of them, I'm sure, are first-time mushroom purchasers. Yeah. What do you really say to them?
Give them a friendly welcome. And usually they want the whole rundown, like I just told you, maybe even some more. Any questions they ask, I'm willing to try to give an answer. Sometimes they come with very hard questions, and then I'll probably say, give me a day or 2 days, I'll try to figure it out. Usually, I think I'm trustworthy. A lot of people, I hope they will think it too. I have some people coming back like, I'm a bit scared. And we'll give them some vitamin C or vitamin B12. Keeps the trip down. So if they need any help, we'll be there also.
No, exactly. Getting back to the mushrooms themselves, what are the different types you have here for sale?
We've got four different kinds. The European one is the weakest. It's the energy one. It gives you an energy boost, little mental thoughts, but not much. Very controllable.
Then what's that called?
This one, the psilocybin. Then we got the regular one in the States. It's the Mexican. If you buy mushrooms in the States, although it's illegal there, you'll probably find those. They're easy to grow at home. That's why a lot of them are grown in the United States. They're the funny ones. Gentle, visual, but a lot of giggly, a lot of happiness. Then we got the fourth one, the Tampanensis, we call it. It's from Tampa, Florida. It's a bit stronger than a Mexican. It's more the what we called. And then we got the Hawaiian. That's definitely the strongest. It means less communicative, more mental process, more your brain is working a bit different. They all last for about 4 hours. It doesn't matter which one. And that's because most people's digestion system is about 4 hours.
And I see here you have Amanita mascara. Yeah. You don't sell that though?
No, it's in comparison to the other ones, this one makes you throw up much, much more. You've got like one in every 50 persons who might throw up on the regular mushrooms. But on the fly garlic, the big toadstool, the big red one with tiny white dots, you throw up, I think, one in every 5 persons will throw up. It's a different trip. It's not as good and not as little and controllable as the regular ones. And that's why we don't sell it.
Now, I noticed that you not only sell magic mushrooms, but you sell a wide variety of other things. What exactly is a smart shop?
Smart shop, the word smart shop comes, the smart part is for good alternatives for bad drugs. Like you got cocaine, ecstasy, amphetamines, they're all illegal. We try to give a better and easier for your body substitute for them. Mostly they're not as strong, but you have to in their own way, they're good enough. If you're not going to compare them, you'll have fun. And that's why we sell like the herbal ecstasies, we sell the herbal energizers, we sell a lot of the sex drugs, which enhances the sex, makes your body tingle, gives you a more horny kind of feeling. And then we got a whole bunch of vitamins, the healthy part. That's why we call it a smart shop.
In Holland, these are in fact legal then, far as everything goes. Where do they come from?
We grow them here, in greenhouses or in big cellars. Some of them are easy to grow, some of them are not so easy to grow. Sometimes we import them from England. And fresh mushrooms have an okay status in England, but dried ones are illegal over there. So and in England you're not allowed to sell them. They've got a better law system for for the mushrooms than there.